All righty, everyone out there this evening, welcome to our board meeting. At this time, I'm going to ask that everyone please rise with us as we recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And I forgot to do my customary smack of the gavel, so I will do it now. All righty, very good. Nice to see everyone this evening on our Thursday night before Thanksgiving. Enjoy always having a nice full house tonight to witness our the workings of the school district and the school board. At this time, I'm going to need an adoption of the agenda. May I have a couple fellow board members step up and do that, please?
Madam President, I move that we adopt the agenda as presented.
Second.
All right, very good. We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All right, very good. Thank you so much. We will now, all those in favor of adopting the agenda, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And those opposed, same sign. All right, very good. We're going to move right into item number 2 on our agenda. That is our superintendent's report. At this time, I will turn this over to our superintendent, Dr. Dennis Carpenter.
Thank you, Madam President, board members. Good evening to our audience. If you'll recall, last month, we did not present on the quarterly update for board priority number 1, given some extensive work Dr. Collier was involved in outside of the district. So we will have her this evening report on quarterly update for board priority number 1. In addition, we'll have a presentation that we're calling Leading and Learning, and that is primarily a reflection of our visit to Park Hill and some of the extensive conversations that continue in our district around the notion of access and opportunity and aligning talent for all learners. And Don Smith will be leading that charge along with maybe some commentary from other members of the group who had the opportunity to go over to Park Hill and do some learning. Dr. Collier.
Good evening.
Parkway.
Good evening. It's always a pleasure to provide an update to you relative to the work of instruction. So tonight, while I'll provide you an update, I would like to be mindful and make sure I announce to you that some areas I won't go as deep into, one, because it's an update, but two, because we will have work session with you in the month of December, where we will plan to deliver some product to you in December. So I'm going to start this evening with reminding everybody about what board priority 1 calls for. First of all, it calls for increasing the achievement of every child through the use of innovative practices, through a focus on student well-being, and through a focus on equity and program design and implementation. And I'm going to touch on all three of those for you this evening. First of all, this summer, we were together in a work session. We talked to you about our goals in the area of instruction and that plan we coined Plan for Performance. And we have multiple objectives that are in progress that, as I mentioned, we will be delivering to you in December. One of those is the design and development of the R7 curriculum management plan and the R7 assessment plan. We currently have teachers that are working in the area of curriculum to ensure that we are enhancing our resources tied to curriculum easily accessible by our teachers through our digital learning environment, Schoology, which you've heard about. So Dr. Flack has been leading our curriculum specialists and our department chairs in that work. And we also have teachers that will begin working second semester on more fully developing assessments. And we'll bring that assessment plan to you that we've been talking about to ensure that we are systemically monitoring the learning of our students K through 12. And we have been working to gather input from our teaching staff and administrators and bringing that plan to you. So we're really looking forward to that. Couple facts I'd like to share with you this evening. When we talked about expansion of our digital learning environment, wanted to share a few pieces of information with you. First of all, we talked about the fact that Schoology was going to be a tool by which parents could further engage in and know about the learning taking place with their students. So this time last year, actually October of last year, we had 1,300 parent visits to Schoology, to student courses throughout the district. To date, this time of year, we have 15,000 parent visits connected to their student learning through Schoology. We would like to, at that point, really commend our building principals for their communication to parents about the importance of that. That would not have happened without our building principals. Huge kudos to our staff that went through training for Schoology, that have been accessing the curriculum. We have teachers that work tirelessly over the summer and that are still working to ensure second semester resources are available, but our staff always demonstrates themselves as learners. And so we have faculty use that is up as well. This time last year, we had 27,000 entries in October for teacher use. That's up to 57,000 entries right now for teacher use. So they're open to learning and exercising change in their classroom. In October of last year, we had 313,000 hits for student use. That means students are accessing Schoology for curriculum, videos, accessing agendas for the day. As I speak to you at this point, we have over 600,000 student use hits at this time. So again, kudos to our staff, students, for really taking on that challenge. And the piece of that is that it's just a connection point. And we talk about through the CFMP future ready learning. It's just a piece that's tying it all together for our students. Next, I'd like to point out too, in the area I have pointed out up here on this slide, opportunity. We're gonna talk a little bit further about that. But all of our building principals and leadership teams across our schools should also be complimented because they have ensured that their building improvement plans are all focused on our board priority goals that I just pointed out to you. I'm sorry, our points in board priority one, innovative practices, well-being, equity, particular in the area of student achievement. They all have math goals defined in their school improvement plans, and that certainly is response to the achievement data that our buildings have looked at. So certainly, again, compliments to our buildings. Portrait of a graduate. We're going to unveil this to you a little bit more specifically in December, but through the leadership of Dr. Kephart and Dr. Sharp, they worked with members of administration, teachers, staff, and community members to begin to articulate this vision, if you will, of what it is we hope for each one of our students as they cross the stage at graduation. What are those skills we hope that they take away and carry out and utilize in their life and in their professions and in their work? And we'll be unveiling that to you in December and doing more with that with staff in January. We're going to spend some time with you at our December work session talking to you further about this notion of expanding online opportunities for our students. And so Dr. Whaley has begun researching and exercising, really digging in deep into practices in different school districts about how we might expand those online opportunities, and then how our board policy will impact that work. We'll be bringing that to you in December. And again, that's further connected to our goal to further expand the digital learning experiences of our students, and that's what's heard through the CFMP, expanding choice options for our students. In the area of student well-being, we have had trauma-informed care that occurred earlier here, first quarter, and we had staff members from all of our schools participate in trauma-informed care, and that certainly close leadership there by Dr. Hill, Dr. Mathis, and Dr. Daniel, and coordinating that and getting to the right people to that training. All of our staff participated in suicide prevention training. We have all of our administrators, particularly at the middle and elementary level, working closely with district leadership on this notion of multi-tier systems of support, how we're monitoring the academic behavior and social emotional needs of our students. That's a system that's growing. You've heard a bit about that before, but again, the learning has been deepened. And then also trying to further expand and get into the hands of our staff, resources that are available within our community, and certainly compliments to Dr. Hill in that area for making sure those are accessible to our counselors. But in our area of well-being, staff well-being, kudos to Jennifer Flax, who's been working with building leadership to further provide opportunities around staff well-being. Because we know as staff take care of themselves, then they too are in a good place to take care of the well-being of our students. And so there's some great, amazing things happening there that weren't happening this time last year. And so again, we believe that's tied to the goal and the partnership with Jennifer Flax. Next, Hour Power. You've heard about 1 hour, one child a week. And so what we know is that mentors matter. And spending time with students one-on-one can change the trajectory of their academic success in school. So I'm going to share with you this website. This is live on our district website, and we are going to be doing communication district-wide after the Thanksgiving holiday. And here, community members can click on an application to complete an application to work with a student K through 12. Our Power, we will match you. So our staff have been working to submit names of students who have a variety of needs that would benefit from this relationship. And then when the mentors or those community members interested in supporting students in this way submit to us their application and have completed the necessary background checks and the necessary training pursuant to board policy, we will match those individuals, and then staff will be prepared in the buildings to get them working with students. I will tell you, that's going to look different K-12. That's going to look different with a kindergartner versus a 15-year-old. And 60 minutes with a 7-year-old might look a bit different than 60 minutes with a 17-year-old. So there's going to be some variety there. But again, kudos to our staff who are aware of the program and trying to submit names. What we know is it's going to grow over time. And with the caring community that we have, we know we're going to see much success. Volunteer hours, volunteer participation in our school district is really quite awe-inspiring already. And we just have the belief that this is going to take it to a whole other level. So we have coordinators in buildings that are going through training, and then all of the mentors will go through training as well. Whoops. One of the things I'd be remiss in sharing when I was talking about some highlights and instruction, I wanted to make sure I go back and also point out that we really owe a debt of gratitude, if you will, to Mrs. Erin Barnett, who is really helping to make sure our innovation track is off and running and working smoothly for students and being an amazing liaison between that program and the school buildings. And so that certainly is a success of first quarter, and would be remiss as well not to mention Dr. Sharp in that. In addition to the implementation of Innovation Track, would also like to extend some thanks and also remind the board that we've just had two of our IB programs go through some intense evaluation this first quarter. And I know Jackie and Dennis, you assisted Lee Summit High School, and Kim and Julie, I believe, at Lee Summit North. So thank you for that. And while we're waiting for the evaluation, we're always proud of those opportunities to stop, pause, and reflect. And then that last point was equity. And in the area of equity, certainly you all participated in our board work session where we talked about our student data. And we have been researching and learning about those next steps relative to further raising the achievement of all students across our school district. So this time I'm going to invite Dawn Smith Ford, and she's going to continue this participation with me as we reflect now also and share with you our learning from our visit to the Parkway School District. So we call this portion of this presentation really leading and learning, because we are a professional learning community. Each one of us are learners, and to continue to grow the organization as leaders, we need to be open to learning. One of the things that's very important is to study and understand really the long-range vision and strategic planning of different school districts, and we do this relative to the many aspects of our organization. So just a quick study of strategic plans across the country, whether it's Illinois, Kansas, Iowa, Utah, Maine, Florida, or right here in Missouri, there are districts all across the country that have equity as part of their strategic plan. They all have the goal of raising achievement for all students. They have the goal of educating staff relative to diversity and inclusion. And so some of those examples are ones that we can look to study, to understand how they have moved their staff around this particular topic.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Collier. It is my pleasure this evening to share our learning experience with everyone. And so as we continue to learn and lead in this process, we looked at several neighboring school districts. We looked at districts within the state, outside of the state, as well as some international things that are going on with equity. And so we landed on Parkway, and Parkway School District stood out as a nationally recognized district in the work of social justice and equity. And this district was highlighted in the October edition of American School Board Journal. And so the purpose of our visit was to learn more from a school district with a similar demographic makeup, such as Lee Summit as well. And so we wanted to learn in this learning point the implementation and their experience with the work of equity. And so we spent an entire day in Chesterfield, Missouri, in Parkway School District. And the day started out and included, obviously, an overview of the work and the journey of the work of social justice and equity. And so one of the points that the group, the superintendent, along with the superintendent's advisory group, pointed out was a defining moment and how this journey even started. And so one defining moment was definitely an incident on a bus with a black student. And from that incident, the group took time to definitely self-reflect. And in that self-reflection came up for them was student-centered versus adult-centered. And so they really had to change their mindset in what type of district they wanted to be. Was it an adult-centered or a student-centered district? And so that one defining moment changed the course of this work of social justice and equity in Parkway School District. And so we also learned from the group as a whole, but we broke out into work-alike groups. And some of those work-alike groups were academics, it was student services, data, operation, communications, public relations. And so as we had our overview and our conversation with the entire group, once we got into those work-alike groups, we were able to just definitely dig a little bit deeper and ask more specific questions to each of our areas. And so those conversations took place by way of sharing success stories as well as some missteps, but also some additional defining moments and some additional work in social justice and equity throughout the school district. This work just doesn't stop at the school district. It's very fluid within the community. And so as Parkway shared those types of stories with us, we then came back and we really just met to process more. What did we hear? What were our common themes? What were our takeaways? And so we want to share some more of those with you. And on the academic side, several takeaways here. One was a multi-year professional learning plan that supports everyone in this work, because Parkway definitely communicated that this work will not sustain without ongoing learning for everyone. And that means internally and externally. So we know that that's going to be very important as we move forward. This has sustained their process and ongoing practices. The other is the facilitation of learning that has evolved over time. Again, this learning in the work of social justice and equity is fluid. It doesn't just stop at the top. It goes throughout, from the top all the way down, even to students. Student services and data operations, some takeaways there was the work of equity is definitely embedded within the culture. Parkway's experience and their defining moment has made this very fluid. This work doesn't sit in one department. This work is across departments because it is embedded with the culture and the climate of the entire school district. Resources are aligned to student needs. And so when they're looking at budgeting, when they're looking at what a student needs, like one example was use a bus or transportation to get students to and from some activities or opportunities or different experiences throughout the community. And so that was very important to them. And so one of the questions from our group was, well, where do you find the funds? And they say, we find the funds to make what we need to make happen for our kids. And so it's just aligned to everything that they do in terms of resources. The defining moment movement and being able to move forward in the work of equity. We've had our defining moments, and we heard from our board, we've heard from external as well as internal community members. And we know that our board supports this work. And so we've had other common themes throughout, which was also human resources. Dr. Dale Sim was a part of this work-alike group, as well as next is Kelly Rachel, who definitely was part of this as well.
Good evening. I very much enjoyed my visit with Amy, their chief of human resources in Parkway, and had three main takeaways: the data, the recruiting, and the hiring of their staff. Captured in three ways the data they began there, which is where we've started in Lee's Summit, looking at that. And as it relates to staff, they looked at the diversity gap between staff and student demographics, which I presented to you in August in our HR update. And they drilled down the school and department level, and then the differences in having one-to-one conversations with principals, and then moving that forward to their hiring practices is how they looked at that data. They went to recruiting and went very direct in their recruiting methods to be more purposeful and intentional with that. They began networking with diverse educators and marketing their district as a place that embraces diversity. And then with hiring, they went very intentional with their hiring. When they hire administrators, they seek out diverse applicants. They continue the application process, and they've really streamlined that process from the interview to have a diverse applicant. To have a diverse interview team that looks at all of their applicants before moving that forward through a process. So as I was visiting with her, she said that all of that, as Dawn has mentioned, aligns with their strategic plan, moving that forward through their equity lens. And as the HR person, you know, I'm thinking, oh, did they have a certain set of questions that helped them through this process? Did they have a certain interview day that they went to that helped them? And my big takeaway in talking with Amy was that she said this wasn't an overnight fix. She said it happened over many, many years. But the big moment that struck me in visiting with her was that she said it was at heart, after all their equity work and all of their discussions, that it is something that is at their heart in Parkway.
Good evening. One of the opportunities we had while we were at Parkway to visit with their team, talking about the breakout sessions. So Parkway has a communications team of 5 professionals. So I sat down with them and talked about, from the conversation aspect, how do you continue the conversation of equity and do so in highlighting your students and your staff and the community who help you externally with that conversation. So as you can see on the slide, what I really put up here was an example that this is a conversation happening across the country. And I think the headlines really tell us that there's a wide variety of understanding about equity, right? So we've been hearing, how do you define equity in Lee Summit School District? How do you define equity in school districts, in the professional working world, and in our community? And so one of the things that we talked about was that definition and how to really propel that into the community and internally to continue having productive dialogue around the work of equity. So my takeaway was just visiting with them and learning about their approaches through whether it be video work and highlighting student stories, whether it be their e-news, whether it be their website. And again, the thing that really struck me that Dr. Del Sim mentioned was this cross departmental approach, right? Don Smith mentioned that as well. How does the idea of equity permeate through all of the departments and all of the work that we do in a school district? And how does it become embedded in decision making and in the service that we provide for all of our kids? So it was all about the conversation and how do we propel the conversation into that internal and external space in the way that we want to have the conversation go.
Okay, thank you. And so we know as a school district, we've definitely had work and practices of equity. And so some of those have been our school improvement plans and how we've identified our subgroup performance data and aligning those to any goals that we set for so that we can provide the support. The other is the implementation of the equal opportunity schools at each high school, as well as our AVID program. We do have a district diversity team. That team does sit in the Office of Student Services. And so right now we are looking at revisiting our goals, our purpose, and what our focus will be. The other have been some book studies that have been done and conducted throughout our school district to support staff in their learning and to springboard some learning around best practices of equity. And so those have all been great. But we want to make sure that we have a systemic plan that will sustain this work, because it is important. And so as we look and reflect on our journey toward being equitable and having a plan for that, we want to develop an equity plan for our school district. And we want some next steps that will consist of us looking at district-wide ongoing professional learning for our board, for our superintendent's leadership team, district and building leaders, and staff, and that's all staff. How do we do this? Well, it's a great question. Through our RFP process, we would like to consult a consultant group to provide ongoing training and support this work, system-wide focus decision-making in equity, and as well as protocols. We want to make sure that we reinforce practices to have an equity approach and a lens in our hiring process. One of the things that Dr. Del Sim mentioned about Parkway, in terms of basically that is really embedded and ingrained in a place called HEART, right? And so we want to make sure that we enhance our multi-tier systems of support to incorporate culturally relevant teaching and learning with well-being as well as support for behaviors. And we don't want to do this in isolation. We know that it's a continuous cycle of multi-tier systems of support. And so definitely want to help and honor our staff in that. We want to make sure that we're looking at special programming to support more experiences and opportunities for all students. We want to make sure that we lead and participate in conversations. We want listening and learning sessions, not only with staff and teams, but with our community as well. And we want to make sure that everything we do is aligned to strategies, resources, and goals, not even in school improvement plans, but in our district-wide consolidated school improvement plan, as well as Destination 2021. And so, just to summarize, we are ready to move forward. We know that this will be a journey in our learning for everyone, and so we want to make sure that we're all going in one direction. Thank you. Any questions?
All right. Fellow board members, does anyone have any questions for any of these outstanding individuals here? Let's see. Okay, looks like Ms. Doan does. Board Member Doan?
Mm-hmm. I'm number five. Can I go back to the mentoring part? I know we're going to have a work session, correct, next month? Mm-hmm. So will we have some kind of prototype that we can go through? Because people have questions, and I want to make sure that...
Sure, yes, absolutely. So when we have our communication that Kelly Wachel will be putting out to the community, we'll ensure that you as a school board also have that information in advance to understand what's on the application, what are the steps. So I have a flow chart, if you will, of the process associated with that. We'll ensure that you also have that flow chart so you can explain the steps to anyone that you might speak to about that.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Anyone else? Kim?
Yeah, just a quick question. When you visited Parkway, did they specify which program that they, which company they used or which program they used?
It was the Educational Equity Consulting Group.
Out of where?
I believe that's St. Louis.
Okay, so they're pretty close by.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Do we have any other further questions or comments? All right, Ms. Jackie.
This one's for you, Dawn. Sorry. I didn't mean to catch you walking away. It's even with my glasses on, sometimes I can't see the slides very well. You had mentioned in your opening remarks that obviously you all visited Parkway. We all knew you were heading there, and you mentioned some out-of-state and international, and maybe I'm a bad listener, but I just kind of wanted to get a sense of where either the diversity group or the team that visited Parkway, what all you are looking at as other models for planning around addressing the achievement gap.
Besides Parkway?
Yes, ma'am.
Some other school districts within. I have made some contacts with Kansas City Public Schools. Belton does this work as well. I have not, but I am familiar with some of the work in Lawrence, Kansas. Of course, we recently, after Parkway, was a visit to North Kansas City. North Kansas City held a one-day training for their entire staff, and so they were happy to oblige me to be able to be invited to sit in their debriefing, in which that took place, and there were some takeaways from that as well. It's very similar to our takeaways and common themes in Parkway, but definitely the support of the board, support of the superintendent, being very involved in that work, in the learning process as well. And so the debriefing was among staff who were facilitators for the day. Mm-hmm. So they discussed their successes, some opportunities, and some ongoing need for more internal work.
Okay, mm-hmm. Great. And then you also mentioned in your presentation that the diversity team is working on the goal, mission, vision, goals, mm-hmm. and some of the best practices and developing that systemic plan for addressing the equity issue. Have you begun to create any kind of a timeline that, you know, we often get asked, okay, you know, what's happening next? And it's whether it's boundaries or anything else. Do you guys kind of have a sense of, you know, is it a quarter or months or where you are?
So the goal is to at least have a plan by, I would say, February in terms of a good working timeline. Because one thing that I am accustomed to, and the team has talked about this, is these practices, this work does not happen in isolation. So we're not going to do training here and then put programming on hold. The expectation is that these bullets are continually moving. And so one doesn't operate outside of the other and vice versa. Mm-hmm. All right.
All right. Very, very good. Thank you so much. Really, I bet that was a lot of fun. It was enlightening to be with fellow members from across the state. Dr. Carpenter?
The only thing that I would add is, and thank you, ladies, for an awesome job, and thank you all for indulging the Parkway group in a, for that full day. What I will share is they used a word, and that word's still sticking with me from Parkway. They talked about difficult work in school districts that continue to have struggles with achievement and gaps between some subgroups in relationship to others. And Parkway was pretty candid that they haven't closed all of their gaps. They were pretty candid about that. But what they did say is that they feel extremely confident that they've created a culture for all kids to have access to the opportunities in Parkway. I mean, it was very interesting when the deputy superintendent shared that now she gets calls from teachers and even from students about how something may be inequitable and how can they help in fixing it. So my question to her was, how do you respond to those calls? Where does your thinking go when you hear that call? And she immediately said, whatever it takes for every kid. We start with, we're going to get it done if it's what's best for kids. And that was a big takeaway for me because we all deal with funding issues. We all deal with operational issues associated with doing the work of effectively educating children. But just to start with that mentality of let's get started. That was very, very clear. And they used another word that I'm going to talk about, and that word is allies. There is a person in that district, by all accounts, is the champion of this work, and she's been that way for a long time. So she is no doubt their Don Smith, i.e. their hired person in the area. But she talked a lot about the fact that she's developed allies across departments, across the community, and it's not just her work. She said it's a heavy rock or brick, she said, I think she said rock, to push uphill. But her allies that know what's best for children are helping her to push that rock. And so I kind of pushed on that a little bit and said, tell me more about the rock and, you know, can it get too heavy and can this work be done? She said, you do realize that no matter how hard it gets, Dr. Carpenter, there's some of us that will not stop pushing this rock. That was pretty profound to me. She said, you do realize that it, no matter how hard it gets, Dr. Carpenter, there's some of us that will not stop pushing this rock. So I've been thinking about that because that played in my mind and I unpacked it a little bit with the team that went over. And that was another burning takeaway for me because when I think about my career and how I've made a living for myself and my family, I made it trying to do what I think is right for all children. And it's probably not a rock that I'm prepared to stop pushing either. It's just that important for young people. So with that being said, I'm glad to see our movement. And I'm going to respectfully ask of our board, you know, we've been put in a place where we were moving in this direction. And I wrote it in my most recent blog. We were already heading in this direction. But I wrote in my blog that some things were taken out of context and prematurely thrust into the public domain because we were going in this direction anyway. And what I would hate for our community or anyone in our community to believe is that we're doing this because of some external pressure. I stopped to tell everyone that I'm always going to do this because it's what's best for young people. So I'm going to respectfully just ask us to consider allowing this group that's more than capable to do their work. And this conversation doesn't have to play itself out in the boardroom. You're going to prove many items tonight. They don't play themselves out in the boardroom. And the work of effectively educating all children and equity, it doesn't have to play itself out in the boardroom either. We know best practices. We know models. We're going to go do the work. So that's what I would offer in terms of any closing remarks. But I would tell you a key component, and I'll conclude with this. Dr. Marty, school superintendent, time and time again, he said this work sustains itself because it's difficult in nature, because it starts with me. And he was pretty candid. It started with superintendents before me, so it didn't take a lot. It was part of me coming in. But it's me and that school board. He said we have to be on first base as it relates to the learning, because we know that we are the ones, when it gets difficult, we're going to hear the commentary, we're going to hear the pros, we're going to hear the cons. So it starts with the learning of the superintendent and the school board. Lots of things we do, we want it to be organic. But this work, preparing our system to do something better in a system that really hadn't done all the things it could do in this respective area, you can't expect that to happen organically. It's going to happen around this table, and I think the team is ready, and we're going to put forth these plans, and we'll be coming to you for some implementation pieces, and we'll just ask, so let's take it out of the boardroom and let's go do the work.
All righty. Very nice. Thank you. Thank you very much for that. That kind of segues into my president's remark. I have added a section in there where I'd have an opportunity just real to touch on things that are going on. And this week is American Education Week, and I sit up here with some fellow educators. And so what I did is this week I asked any of them that might have done it to speak on just real briefly about a teacher that might have influenced them. Because after all, we know those kiddos are who they are because of great teachers that believed in them and supported them. So does anyone want to go first with theirs? Does anybody have one that they'd like to talk about? Ryan Murdoch, go for it, Board Member Murdoch.
I was ready. So President Bellani did ask us to come up with a teacher. So my teacher is James Morrill, who was the debate and forensics teacher at Raytown South when I was there. And I know Dr. Hill probably knows him and his wife. So I only bring him up because I know students who are in those particular programs, we spend a lot of hours with that particular person. You get home from tournaments at 11 p.m. on a Friday. You're back up there at 5:30 a.m. on a Saturday. And he was a mentor for all of us within the debate program. He was a leader for our program. And he was somebody I think that everybody looked up to. We still, as a group of us, I mean, we're talking about people who have graduated now 20, 25 years ago, and we still get together for brunches together, those of us who are within the debate and forensics program. That's awesome. And I'm just going to finish with this one little story about him. He did have a sense of humor, a very good sense of humor, by the way. But we were in a final round to qualify for nationals for in team debate, my partner and I. We had a very close round, oddly, against a team from Lee Summit High School. They didn't win. But we thought they had won because he came out of the tabulation room as we were waiting to find out if we had won the round. And he gave us the most morbid, I'm so sad for you guys look that you've ever seen in your life. And then he actually just winked at us and gave us a thumbs up and turned and walked away. And I was just like, you, but it was awesome. And he's somebody that I still look up to, even to this day.
Very good. Thank you so much. Anybody else? I heard Bob click his clicker. So Mr. White.
Mm-hmm. I would have to say that every teacher that I had an impact on me in one way or another. There are many, many teachers that I had that I thought did a great job, and I really enjoyed their classes, and then there were some that I didn't, and some coaches that I didn't care much for. And I think in my teaching over years, what I've tried to do is to emulate those people that I thought did a great job and not do the things that I didn't like when they were done to me. But there are a couple of people that I would, you know, one would be Harold Wamscons, who I had his very first year of teaching, a wonderful man. And I think I may have been influenced to go into teaching partially because of Harold. I can't think of his last name at the moment, but my math teacher, my freshman year or my sophomore year in high school, I was not a good math student, but he made math fun. And then Seth McClinic, my senior English teacher. And he instilled in me a love of good literature and poetry, which has sustained me my whole entire life. So those were folks that had a profound impact on me, and I have managed to let them know that, which doesn't always happen. I was fortunate enough to have Coach Wams come and work here at Lee Summit. Surprised the heck out of me that he showed up, and when I was still teaching, and I took it upon myself every chance I got to say, "Hey, Coach, you know, you're one of the reasons that I went into teaching." And I know that feels pretty good, because if you're a teacher and somebody says that to you, it's like, man, you can run for another 4 or 5 years on that. So those are mine.
That was awesome, Bob. Thank you so much. Anybody down this direction over here want to share? Miss Julie Doan?
Well, my teacher is Mrs. Combs, and for all of you who don't know her, is the mother of Mrs. Robbie Little. And I always tell Robbie Little she wasn't my favorite teacher because I had her too. But Mrs. Combs, little Julie Shuck came in from presentation, didn't really know very many people. And at that time, I wasn't an extrovert like I am now. And she really took care of me. And so I always remember her. So I always have to tell that, say that to Robbie Little. And then my track coach. Do I need to say anything? Anyway, we had two track coaches, Coach White and Coach Black, and they both, yeah. talk about equity. But they always pushed us very hard, and so did my gymnastics coach. Mm-hmm. And I want to say her name then, but Patty Barthold, who owns Dave's Gymnastic Factory. Anyway, those were the people that really I thought of right away when I got that note from Miss Phyllis.
Mm-hmm. So, you bet.
Thank you.
All right. Board Member Smith.
Well, Madam President, I've seriously thought about your question that you asked of us, and I mean that sincerely.
Okay.
So, but I'm not going to answer it exactly as you would probably want me to present it.
That's all right.
So you can send me to school board jail if I don't do right here. Or give me detention.
All right, you got it. Detention sounds good.
But I seriously thought about that. And from 1956 to 1969, from Westview to Lee Summit High School, I sincerely mean this, I had the opportunity to have some of the best caring teachers that you could imagine. And then a step further. In 1973, I had the opportunity to come back here and teach. And those of us who've been in education know you go to take all those school of education courses. You student teach. But I learned so much my first few years, all through my career, working side by side by some of those teachers that you didn't learn that in a college classroom somewhere. And then I had the opportunity to be administrator, and I got to observe some of the greatest teachers district-wide that touched every kid's heart so much. So I could narrow it down to one or two, but it really, to be honest, it was a team effort. I'm going to say, somebody up here is going to have a smart remark about that, but no, that's I truly.
No, that was that was wonderful. That was fantastic, and you are certainly not going to get a detention for that. You're going to get a lot of kudos. That was great. That was great. Okay, Vice President. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, yeah, Kim. Mm-hmm.
Hi. Kind of echoing what Dennis said, I'm a product of Lee Summit High School too. But I want to say that some of my best teachers were actually some of the teachers who were the hardest. Mm-hmm. They were the ones who challenged me the most. From my sixth grade teacher in Independence, Mrs. Notes, who was tough as nails. She really prepped me for junior high. And then on to when I got the opportunity, and I say that very fondly, to get to come to Lee Summit High School my ninth grade year, Mrs. K. Ford, who is an icon in this community, ninth grade ninth grade social studies, government class,
was fabulous. She was actually before her time. She went and studied each kid's information in the vault and in their permanent records to determine their background and their potential and their abilities. And then she would use interdisciplinary groups to group us. So you'd have a very high achieving and midway achieving students and a low achieving student all in interdisciplinary groups, kids of all abilities. She'd make three different worksheets. She'd make three different tests for those abilities. And that woman was one of the hardest working women I know. And she's thankful she's still alive and she's still in this community working hard for our kids. So she is an inspiration to me. Also, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Mrs. Mildred Mitchell. She was the icon of the English department, at least I'm in high school. She was my senior English teacher, expository writing, and honors Shakespeare. Leesamit High School was one of the only schools, if only the only school in the state of Missouri, that offered a Shakespeare course. And she taught that Shakespeare course. I took that course and I loved it. And when I was lucky enough to be hired at Leesamit High School in 1981, just a pup going in there with all these teachers that were Mike's teachers. She was so supportive, and at one point, when the year that we brought the International Baccalaureate program into Leesamit, at Leesamit High School, she could no longer teach the Shakespeare course because she was then teaching IB, so she handed over the Honors Shakespeare course to me and let me teach it the last 5 years I taught at Leesamit High School before I became an administrator. So I appreciate all of the confidence that woman placed in me, and she was truly an inspiration. She was hard, but she was fair, and I loved her very much. Well, thank you.
Very, very nice. Thank you. All right, now I'll go down to Vice President Clark.
Well, Dennis went off the rails, so I'm going to do the same because he taught me in ninth grade. I guess probably because I'm wearing some antiques tonight that were one of my grandmother's. I want to say that my grandparents were really a great inspiration, as well as my parents. It's my grandparents that instilled in my parents and supported all four of us in learning and achieving through our tenure in Leesamit schools. And I know that that's why we were able to engage effectively with teachers, at least generally speaking, on a day-to-day basis we did. There are just so many folks that I consider to have been inspirational and that have come back into my life. In sixth grade at Mason, it was my teacher, Jean Trent. And years later, I encounter her in the Mizzou Alumni Association. Like me, she was an international board president, and I got the sweetest note from her when I took office. I could not believe it, and she lives down in Harrisonville now. And it just is amazing the way life circles back around through this district. And then in junior high, I would say that it was, and this is why I was such a great ninth grade social studies student, Dennis, Mr. Betts and Mr. Cahill, they were our history teachers, and they were absolutely wonderful, and we really, really learned the history of this country. And then Mrs. Mitchell, clearly I would have to credit with landing me at Mizzou, and also taught me how to prevent certain students with lower ACT scores from cheating off of me in expository writing exams. When you're really short, people look over your shoulder, and I figured that out. It clearly is the person who came in and out of the ministry and to teach debate at Leesamit High School, and that was George Flanagan. And he was the icon up to now, notwithstanding anybody who's our current coaches, because they are fabulous. I don't want to discount anything there. But at that time, he was iconic. And much like you would be in an honored Shakespeare's class or an expository writing class, we were taught classical rhetoric. We weren't taught to talk fast. We weren't taught to just win rounds. We were taught to be able to analyze what people say and to understand flawed argumentation and nuanced communication and effective communication. So even in the last year, we don't get to see each other a lot. We run into each other in the grocery store more than anything. But I've encountered him, and he's given me his wisdom, and I followed it, I hope, if he ever watches this, to this day. And this district has really been fortunate to have great teachers, and we will continue to hire great teachers to educate all of our kids.
Very good. Wow, I'm really inspired by what you have shared tonight. I have a brief share. I'd like to, like Dennis, I'm a product of the community, and Kim and Julie and Jackie. So kindergarten, I had a lady named Mrs. Pridgen. We called her Pigeon, but her name was Mrs. Pridgen because I ran with an ornery group of kids. Imagine that, okay? Then I had a wonderful lady named Mrs. Owsley, who was fantastic, and I run into her here in Lee Summit. She was always smiling, always happy, a great, great educator. Then I had Mrs. O'Rourke for sixth grade, who was real strict. And that was good because I had fifth grade Mrs. Owsley, happy, cheerful, sixth, strict, got us ready for junior high, which is what we called it back then. I was a child of lessons, and I always knew I wanted to be in the performing arts, and I always wanted to teach performing arts. So I'm going to give a lot of credit to Russ Berlin, who was a big part of my life in junior high in music. I also had a man named Bill Van Pelt, who was the scariest man that I ever knew. But he was a sweetheart, but he was scary too. But he taught me an awful lot about discipline. Then I also had Keith House, who's a legend in music in Lee Summit. Had wonderful vocal teachers. But one of the most influential teachers in my life was a lady named Brenda Warren, who passed away, I believe, a year ago. She was my theater teacher, and I knew I wanted to teach. I couldn't decide if I wanted to teach band, choir, or theater. And so I was TA for her my senior year, and she was expecting her first child, and she was really cranky. And so one day, this is my senior year, she was not feeling well, so she asked me to teach the class, and I did. And I ran it pretty well, pretty effectively, and I knew then that's what I wanted to teach was theater. And then it came time for my partner and I to do our scenes, and here she is sitting down, she didn't feel good, and she goes, "Where's your script?" And I said, "I don't have my script, I've got my lines memorized." She goes, "Isn't that what you were supposed to have, your script with you today?" I said, "No, I have my lines memorized." She sent me to the office. And that's the only first and only time I ever had to go to the office. And it was Bob Dykeman, another big influence in my life. He was our principal at the time, who just grinned at me and said, "Go sit out there for a little bit and then return to class." But I do want to say somebody that really put a lot of pep. I've always had pep in my step, but somebody that continues, when I think of him, I just want to walk and put my head high, because this guy always said, "How you doing? Always a great day," and that's Tom Flint. And he is still alive and very active in church here in Lee Summit. But Dennis, you nailed it, honestly. You nailed it. We have always attracted and had the very best educators. And Jackie, great. Flanagan, I remember him so dearly because he shared that he was a room next door to Brenda Warren. So anyway, but fellow board members, thank you for that. Again, in honor of American Education Week, celebrating our educators. Very good. All right, we're going to move on now to presentations and recognitions. And as like I do every month, I don't want you just to hear my voice. So I've enlisted four board members up here to read those presentations while I get to join Dr. Carpenter and honoring our So let's see, who's first here? I believe that's Julie, right? Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, that's Jackie. Okay, I'll tell you what. Okay, 401.
Each year during American Education Week, which is November 12th through 16th, so we're in the middle of it, National Educational Support Professional Day, celebrated Wednesday, commends the work of school support employees. Our district's building clerks, resource aides, and paraprofessionals are instrumental to employee productivity and the preparation of all of our students for success. Through National Education Support Professionals Day, we honor our school support team members for their tireless efforts to give each of our students and our colleagues the tools they need to thrive. Kathleen Brennan, who works as a social and emotional behavioral para at Pleasant Lee Elementary, will represent all district paraprofessionals with us this evening. Thank you.
Are we ready? All right. In 1921, American Education Week began in order to improve public awareness about the significance of education. Nearly a century ago, when the effort was initiated, almost a quarter of World War I draftees were illiterate. Since its inception, American Education Week has evolved into an opportunity to remember the history of our nation's impact of education and to recognize our school's influence on students and families today and in the future. Early Summit schools are prized as one of the community's most important resources. New neighbors settle in Lee Summit because of our excellent school system, and this significantly benefits our community's business and industry interests. Sorry. Our students' success and the excellence of our schools are a product of the work of our extraordinary staff. Very true. Representing our teachers this evening are some of our excellence in teaching award winners for 2018 and 19. Please welcome Matt Buxton, Nicole Gilbert, Jamie Harrell, Sherry Norton, Kristen Shackelford, and Kelly Wilson. Thank you.
Okay, moving on. I believe, Dennis, you're going to read item 4.03.
Mm-hmm. With real pleasure, I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Heather Kinney, the principal at Summit Point Elementary.
And I forgot to turn my microphone on, but
that's okay.
It's good to see her still smile because she had two of my grandkids and she's still working. I'd like to turn it over to you for the program tonight.
Thank you. So tonight we're at Summit Point's being recognized in the spotlight, and so we have lots of great things going on at Summit Point. Just one of those pieces is a culture building activity through the I Am Noticed network. And so we put together a quick video. Our administrative intern, Molly Ulinger, and Brooke Moorhead are also here tonight representing Summit Point, but we have a quick video to kind of show you what we've been up to.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone. I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble in my drag. No, you're not alone.
Okay. Thank you, Amy, for getting us all set up there. Going to now turn this over to Board Member Murdoch. He has a school spotlight as well.
Yeah, so I have item 4.04, and we want to welcome Curtis Cook, who is the Summit International Studies Academy teacher, and I think you're going to do a presentation for us to showcase the program and some of your students.
Thank you very much for your time. Before I forget, I also am a product of the aforementioned Shakespeare mafia that Mrs. Fritchie was my teacher. Just a little shout out. No, I am. First off, I'd like to thank Dr. Bonison. Originally, he was coming to speak here, but as you may know or not, Summit Tech has their open house tonight. So he is busy recruiting over there and gave us his time tonight. We'll be done in 30 minutes. Don't worry, Dr. Sharp. You said no more than 30. Got it? Okay. if you may not realize that November is also, as much as the other education months, is International Education Month. It was designated by the Department of State a few years back to highlight the importance of global perspective. And what we wanted to do is, talking to the students earlier, they really wanted to show you all the incredible international opportunities that you have, all of us have, in the Lee Summit School District. The global perspective that students come out of here with is really unparalleled. There's very few districts that can host that type, that breadth of experience. So I'm very proud. Obviously, I'm a little biased, but they went around the district, they got people together, and I think they've really presented you a great example of what we have in Lee Summit that we can offer our students. So no further ado.
Hello, my name is Ryan Hampton.
And my name is Emily Harless.
And we are students a part of the International Studies Academy, here to talk to you about the international education opportunities throughout the district that you provide to your students. The international education opportunities include the foreign language programs, and then the international studies program that we are in at the Summit Technology Campus, and then the abroad opportunities that are within the district as well.
Mm-hmm. And so first we're going to talk about the language programs that we offer. And so with the language programs, we really like to show how much it's touched the students in the district as well as the teachers, and how many students it reaches. The ELL program alone reaches nearly 400 students and offers services. So we just wanted to highlight those things in our videos.
I was teaching in another high school, and I knew that Lee Summit was more cutting edge than where I was, and they were doing some more innovative teaching methods, and I was ready for a change.
And French really opens up a lot because a lot of countries speak French, and in history classes in most of American schools, you don't really learn about African history, and in French you learn a lot about African culture and about the history.
I like that in this class we have conversations every day about topics that are current in the real world, so we're learning vocabulary that's actually important.
I love the idea that we can have 5 years of a language, and that's something that a lot of districts don't have. I also love the support for all of the languages, not just Spanish, that our German program is strong, our French program is strong, and the support is there for the Chinese program as well.
Since I'm a Latina, for me teaching Spanish is passion, because I get the opportunity to teach my students about my culture, my language. The teachers like Ms. McKee has the sign language. So we do offer a great variety.
I'm in the Mandarin program here at school. I've been in it for 5 years. I want to go into international business, and to where I'll work over here in the United States, but I'll work for a company that deals with China multiple times, probably on the daily. If it would have not been for that, my career focus and plans would be completely different.
Next, we'll be talking about our program that we come from. We are two students from the Summit Technology Academy, specifically the International Studies program. And so what we do in that class is we're dealing with a lot of international education and hands-on experience. We travel to the Kansas City International Academy, Don Bosco, and we have Socratic seminars where we're discussing real life issues. And We have three students that we interviewed about the program.
My favorite part is probably get to work with kids in Kansas City International Academy. So the diversity with those kids that are 7th and 8th graders, that's probably my favorite part.
My favorite part about the International Studies course is learning different languages and also learning about different cultures and a cultural appropriation.
I personally feel prepared really well to view cultures on a different outlook. Rather than viewing them as weird, I view them as interesting and want to learn more.
The business portion of it with Global Prep Squad, we're able to focus on pitches, and it gives us more availability to work on pitches, because before this class I had never done that.
Some benefits are, so say like if I was to visit a different country, I would know what to do, what not to do, and I would know more about the people and their culture.
And lastly, our foreign exchange program, which is in itself an amazing program, and it's great that the Lee Summit School District offers it, because like not only the students but the teachers get to create these connections that can be lifelong sometimes with people from all around the world in like the learning environment and outside of school.
I love learning about other cultures and countries, other people. I think I have a background in Spanish and French. I taught overseas for a while.
There are exchanges that we have set up with different countries and different school districts. We have one with Dijon, France, and so this summer we'll be traveling there for the third exchange. And get to stay with real French families, real French culture.
I hope to expand my own opinions and perspectives of other people and to learn new things.
I think what I really appreciate is the fact that in Lee Summit we celebrate different languages, we appreciate the diversity that provides.
I really enjoy teaching in Lee Summit School District because this school district offers really, really strong international education program.
Now, we offer so much to our students, especially if you go into the upper levels. In our upper level classes, students can earn college credit. Students can get credits that actually go towards a minor. And by the time they're in our upper level classes, they really have some proficiency where they can begin to use the language, and then they're able to go into the community and help community members who speak Spanish. They're able to go out into the world and just connect with others. And then also we just approved and are implementing the Seal of Biliteracy and the Pathway Awards, and we are one of the first Kansas City metro area schools to pass and implement the awards.
With the school, I've been able to travel to France, so I feel like I have a lot of experience, and so in college I'll be able to take higher learning French classes and do really well and do study abroad programs, and it'd be really easy for me to
implement the awards.
I'm personally preparing for the Seal of Biliteracy for my Mandarin class, and I'm personally really excited about this because I'm really excited about the opportunities that the seal could give me in the future.
With the school, I've been able to travel to France, so I feel like I have a lot of experience, and so in college I'll be able to take higher learning French classes and do really well and do study abroad programs, and it'd be really easy for me.
In honor of International Education Month, we have now given a brief overview of the international education opportunities that are provided through the students throughout the district, and we extremely thank you for these opportunities. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Outstanding presentation. Thank you. Fellow board members, are there any comments any of you would like to make, questions that you may have?
Thank you.
Kim?
Just real quick, how many of you noticed the article in the Lee Summit Journal on their program, on the International Studies program? Did anybody out there notice that article? Nobody got to see that? Nobody takes the journal anymore. Excellent article. Oh my goodness. It was fabulous. I was so proud that you all were featured on the front page of the journal. That's fantastic. So congratulations to you all.
Thank you so much.
Very good, Kim. Thanks for sharing. Yes, Vice President Clark?
I just want to say that the Missouri Chamber Board was meeting here in Kansas City today, and they talked specifically about you guys' program and the kind of work that we're accomplishing over there. So there's a bright future for you. You don't have to go to another country. You can work internationally from Kansas City and in Lee Summit, too. So we just want you to know that. We don't want to lose really great kids.
Yeah,
be great adults.
Very nice. Any other comments? All right. Again, let's give them a round of applause. Very nice presentation tonight. Thank you very much. Thank you. And you have any questions you want to ask us?
Me personally, I do not believe I have any.
Okay.
Do you know?
Oh, that sounded like he was going to come with a good...
I don't have any questions.
All right. All right.
Thank you all so much.
Yeah. Thank you. Keep up the great work. Congratulations. That was nice. That was great. Okay, this is our time in the board meeting where we hear any comments from the public. Miss Linda, do we have any tonight?
Yes, we have one, Leah McIntosh.
Okay, very nice. So Miss Leah McIntosh will invite you right up here to the podium, and Dr. Gates will start the timer.
Okay, thank you. And there are copies of what I'd like to share. Good evening, board, Dr. Carpenter, and staff. I am Leah McIntosh, the mom of three children who attend Cedar Creek Elementary, and I speak tonight on behalf of the growing number of African-American families in Lee Summit. And as a member of Suburban Balance, whose mission is to inform, educate, and empower families of color. Educational equity means ensuring that each child has the resources, teachers, and well-being and support that they need to be successful. We are grateful that this board has named equity as one of its top priorities. We are grateful that members of the board, including our Chair Phyllis, Mr. White, Dr. Carpenter, Dr. Collier, and others have participated in recent equity forums. We are really grateful. And many of you all have attended and been supportive of those conversations. The next community forum on equity organized by Suburban Balance will be Thursday, December 6th at 6:30 at New Generation Christian Center. Ryan Murdoch and Dr. Carpenter have agreed to be there, so thank you for that. Everyone is welcome at those forums. As a group of parents and concerned citizens, we are aware that this board establishes priorities for student learning, including the hiring of staff and choosing relevant curriculum. We are aware that the board sets district priorities that include how school discipline is administered. We are aware that the board adopts the school district budget and decides how money is allocated. We are aware that this board hires the superintendent and holds him and the staff accountable for measurable outcomes. Tonight, we as parents reiterate our support for educational equity and the work of Dr. Carpenter and staff in these efforts. We've had many conversations about the difference between equality and equity, and it's time for even more substantive conversations that include solutions, and we're grateful that that is starting tonight. We are calling for the board, Dr. Carpenter, and the leadership team to focus in five areas. Number one, equity training. Number two, curriculum review. Number three, hiring of diverse teachers and staff who are culturally sensitive and ethnically diverse. Number four, program review, which we hear is already beginning to happen, so that we ensure students have equitable access to those advanced programs in particular. And finally, IEP and discipline policy review to ensure that the practices are equitable. We believe this is a pivotal moment in time. This work will be uncomfortable. However, if we do the work together, our community will be stronger and more inclusive for all students and families. Thank you.
Very nice. Thank you, Leah. Yes. Thank you for that tonight. Okay, we're going to move on to item number 6, board reports or meetings. Do we have anything that we would like to share? Any of the meetings that we worked on this week? Ms. Julie Doan, I saw your hand go up.
Yeah, I just quickly wanted to remind everyone the mayor's character breakfast is January 24th, so hope to see everyone there. And then the Holly Festival that is put on by Lee Summit Cares and PTA. They raised $14,000 for the DARE programs. And then I guess we have a CAC meeting after Thanksgiving. So that's it. Thank you.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Board Member Smith.
Just a couple things. We will have a TIF meeting on November 19th, Monday, mm-hmm. Concerning some property out basically across from Lowe's and yes. Jack Stack there. Then, as Julie has said, November 26th, we have a Citizens Advisory Committee meeting right here.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Let's go down to Board Member Murdoch. You have anything?
No committees this month. Business Roundtable comes up in a couple weeks.
Yep. Thank you very much. Okay, Kim?
Of course, I always have a Lee Summit Educational Foundation report. The foundation would like to thank V's Restaurant for hosting our last Connect for Kids event. We appreciate their support. The next Connect for Kids event is at Tiffin J's on December the 3rd from 5 to 8 p.m., and we invite you and your friends to attend. 15% of sales that evening supports the foundation-funded programs, so please come out to Tiffin J's on December 3rd for dinner. Giving Tuesday is on November the 27th, and if you would help us promote through social media outreach by encouraging, sharing our posts, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all of those things, and encouraging your network to give to the foundation's Helping Hands Fund and for the spirit of our in the spirit of our community. Helping Hands Fund has already assisted two families this year through crisis situations. And your generosity is truly appreciated for that. And just wanted to mention, too, that they have their first meeting. Preparations have begun for Taste of Lee Summit. Mark your calendars, March the 2nd. That's the first Saturday evening in March. This year's theme is Helping Hands. And if you have connections for auction items, please let Cheryl, Frankie, or I know. And we would love to talk to you. Just one other thing. Some of us had the opportunity this last month to attend on November 2nd. We attended a lunch event with Governor Parson. It was sponsored by the Independence Chamber of Commerce. And at that particular event, he emphasized workforce development. It was a very good speech, a very strong speech, and it reinforced what we are trying to accomplish in our school district. So I really very much appreciated attending that event. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Kim. All right. Mr. White?
We have Finance Committee report, but that's later on.
So. Okay. Awesome. And Vice President Clark?
In my GR responsibilities, I did attend last month's Lee Summit Chamber Government Relations Committee and reported on the board's three annual priorities to just give a brief update. It's a very brief roundtable type offering for our updates in that context. Of course, I'm sure everyone is thrilled that the election year advertisements have ceased, regardless of what interest you had in the elections. And we have now shifted gears into, on behalf of the district, looking forward to our day in the Capitol. And I had the good fortune this week last year we couldn't go to the Senate leadership because we didn't know who it was going to be this year. Well, now we know, and we already have the Senate President Pro Tem and the Senate Floor Leader ready to receive us.
Right, that's awesome. And what is the date on
that? No, we don't have a date yet. And then also, of course, we saw the governor on the 2nd over in Independence, as well as he had a nice tribute to veterans on the 11th out at Arrowhead. So that was really great to be able to acknowledge the 100th anniversary of the end of World War I.
All right, very nice board, and like Ryan, I do have a business roundtable coming up soon as well, and thank you for those great reports. All right, we're going to move right into item number 7. These are items for decision. We're going to start with finance, and who's doing that tonight? Bob? All right, Board Member White, take it away.
The Finance Committee reports as follows. Investments through October total approximately $67.2 million. Our revenue and expense report, our expense percentages are within expected budget parameters. The current unaudited fund balance for October is at 19.7%. Construction and maintenance update. Updates were provided in process and completed projects, which included the Woodland Elementary Sewer Project, paving, middle school track resurfacing, the Bernard Campbell Middle School intercom replacement, Lee Summit West retaining wall, and Westview roof improvements. In other items that were discussed, later on we will hear about the We Try curriculum. Special Services Department has researched the Why Try, not We Try, for our standardized core curriculum in the district for social-emotional behavior teachers. Why Try is based on sound empirical principles, social and emotional intelligence, and multi-sensory learning. Allegiant Technology, this proposal is for the first phase of a project with the end goal being to modernize the phone system to use features that will reduce the hardware need to support the phone system, ensure the phone system stays up to date to be supported by the manufacturer, and prepare the transition to telephone service lines that are not legacy. All of these items will improve the reliability of the district's phone system. And we did preview the Finance 101 presentation that was done at our workshop, and I'd like to thank Emily and Wesley for an outstanding job of keeping us abreast of school finances, which is never an easy thing for someone to understand. But they did an excellent job of making it understandable. Our actions tonight, I have two, actually, looks like I only have one motion. I have two motions. The other one's on the back page. Our first motion is to approve the transfer of $4,409,165.87 from the general fund to the special revenue fund.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? At this time, we will take a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. All right, excellent.
Next motion is to approve the treasurer's report and the payment of the bills.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All right, we shall take a vote on that. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? All righty, great work, Finance Committee. All right, we're going to move into number eight, items for decision. This is a consent agenda, just so that everyone knows out there in our viewing audience and our audience tonight that these are items that are lumped into one grouping, and the board does take the time to read through each, and we do have all these items. So what I'm going to ask for right now is a motion and a second.
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All righty, Vice President Clark has made the motion, and Board Member Smith, and is there any discussion about any of these? All right, Ms. Ritchie.
Yes, on 8.06, our academic calendar, August 7th seems like very early date for teachers to return to school, and August 14th for the start of the school year. I just remember last year, I don't know if you remember our discussion last year, we discussed the start date of school creeping closer and closer to the beginning of August, and it was said there that there should be an adjustment back a week in the coming year or two. That was a comment that was made. I don't know if y'all remember that. And I would just ask the question, I assume that we consult with other school districts when setting our calendar dates. Just help me understand, what was that discussion or that conversation?
I passed that. Dr. Del Sim, she greatly led that committee, and they've been meeting, so she has all the intel. Dr. Del Sim.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that question. We did submit to our committee. We had a healthy discussion on that very topic and had two drafts go out. Those drafts went out to the schools, and one draft had the proposed calendar in front of you. The other draft had the exact date you're talking about, Ms. Fritchie, with a week later start. And the draft that rose to the top is the one in front of you. The later start created an imbalance in the two semesters where the days, you had about 90 days in the second semester and only about 80 in the first semester. And particularly, well, really for all our grade levels, but it's secondary, you know from your own experience what a difficulty that brings. So it was a resounding thumbs up. Although everybody likes to start later, we like to start late and end early. That doesn't always work.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Del Sim, for that explanation. Okay, Mr. Murdoch?
One quick question. I have this similar question on the calendar aspect, and I know that we mentioned it in our meeting here just a couple of days ago. I'd like us to at least investigate what we're doing for election days on federal election days in getting the teachers to have an actual day off and not being in service on that day to where our buildings are completely empty on those days. Mm-hmm. To provide them a better chance, one, obviously to vote, but two, to make sure that our facilities are being, since they're being used as polling locations, that they're actually empty if we can at all, if at all possible. I mean, I'd love to see us have national holidays for voting, but on that Tuesday, but I'd like to investigate that possibility if we could.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I might point out relative to professional development that's planned on those days, I know through Dr. Daniel's team and others, we've tried to be mindful of moving professional development out of buildings where there is voting going on. So that is one effort that we've started to make and want to make sure the board was aware of that.
Okay. All righty. Is there any other comments, discussion? Okay. Uh-huh. Mr. Murdoch?
Sorry. Last one. I promise. Would you anticipate that going into the 2021 school year that we will push the calendar forward by a week?
That topic is on the horizon with that committee, and that committee was really great to work with. It can go either way on calendar. People are pretty passionate about it, and I enjoyed that group. They even requested that rather than meeting next fall, we convene this spring to start highlighting some of those topics, and that would be one of them.
Mm-hmm. All righty, very good. All right, if there are no other points of discussion, thank you, staff, for those explanations. We will now take a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. All right, very good. Item number 8 has been approved. We will move right now into item number 9. These are items for decision. And we're going to approve new contracts over $5,000. Please note that item 10.9.02 has been moved to down for items for decision. So I'm going to need a motion.
I move that the board approve new contracts over $5,000 as presented in consent item, agenda item 9.02.
Second. All righty, we have a motion and a second. A discussion? Anybody? All right. With no discussion, we will move on to take a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And all those opposed, same sign. All right. Very nice work, guys. Okay. We're going to move into item number 10. Now, this is items for decision. I believe each one of these we will vote on separately. So we will take a look at item 10.01 first. These are new courses for the 2019-20 school year. Dr. Carpenter?
Absolutely. Madam President, we'll have Dr. Flack come up and take us through our new courses. We looked at this in a great degree of detail on Tuesday and pretty excited about these offerings and how they can fit with the existing staff. Right, sir?
Yes.
Let's do it.
Okay, so good evening. We have 12 courses that we're bringing to you for approval tonight, and some of those courses have corresponding courses that will go off the books, so some of these are replacement courses. So I want to start by talking a little bit about the process so you're aware of how courses are selected and the process that we go through to identify and put these through various committees and groups to look at. And so the first process is identifying new courses that could be proposed, and those come either from internal, whether it's a curriculum team, administrators, teachers, etc., It could be business community members, industry saying we really would like to see courses in this or that, or it could come from agencies such as DESE or National Science Teachers Association, et cetera, might be, you know, come up with new courses. And so that group that course process starts with our department chairs and curriculum specialists. And I want to take a moment to pause and recognize we have three of our department chairs and curriculum specialists here. Sherry Norton, who's our department chair for business management and information technology. Frank Vogue, who's in charge of 712 science. He's our 712 science curriculum specialist. And Kathy Nash, who's our family and consumer sciences department chair. And those individuals, as well as a group of about 12 other department chairs and curriculum specialists, really carry the heavy load in identifying new courses and writing the proposals and working with staff members to ensure that that we have a robust course offering in the district. So can't tell you how much I appreciate their work as well as their work with curriculum. So they're here and I wanted to make sure that I recognize those individuals. But courses get proposed to those groups. They take them and write them up and bring them to a group meeting. Those are due on September 28th. Then the entire curriculum department reviews them. The curriculum team reviews them on October 2nd. All of the department chairs have a joint meeting where they discuss options that they're bringing forward. Then it goes to the secondary principals team. The secondary principals review it and weigh in on feasibility and staffing issues and discussions such as that. Dr. Sharp walks them through that process, and I work with them as well. Then it goes to our instructional operations team. They review those new course offerings. Then it goes to the superintendent's leadership team, and then it comes to the Board of Education for your review and hopefully approval. And so that's the how a bill becomes a law process of new courses. No, yeah. No cartoon, no singing, and you're welcome for that. So we have 12 courses. The first two courses are from our modern language department, and really this is to address the need that we have to support our heritage Spanish speakers and our speakers who do really well in level 3. So we're asking to have two courses added. The first one is an IB Spanish 4 high-level course. This is a 2-year sequence course. And you can see the prerequisites. This is weighted 1.0 for students who take the IBHL test. This is offered for 11th grade students. And I'm going to switch to the next slide, which is the second course in Spanish, which is an IB Spanish 5 high-level course. For those of you that are familiar with IB, it's either standard level or high level. So these are higher-level courses. Again, supporting those heritage Spanish speakers and really helping to prepare students for the seal of biliteracy that you recently approved. So this will help with that process. So those are the two modern language courses in Spanish. And then we move to family and consumer sciences. And there are about 5 courses that we're looking to have added for family and consumer sciences. The first one is personal image and relationships. And this is replacing personal image. So this is one of those courses that replaces another. It's available to 9-12 students. And it adds some clarity to our education and training pathway, as well as provides us with better alignment with DESE standards and national standards. And so we're adding that relationships component to that. So that's the first course. And so what I wanted to do here is show you a picture of our pathways that we have in family and consumer sciences. And that course is right there in education and training. So it's clarifying that one. The next course list, there's about 4 courses that we're going to show you, or I'm going to show you. Those are in the apparels, textiles, and fashion pathway. And so this really cleans that pathway up and provides some additional coursework for students that go into that path and will help them be career ready. And so looking at the first recommendation, it's to add a fashion and interior design foundations class. And so this would be a baseline class for anybody that's going to go into fashion or interior design. So that'll be a foundation class. No prerequisite available. You can kind of see the pieces on there. And it allows for a pathway in that fashion and interior design pathway. So the second one replaces our interior design class with an advanced interior design class. So you go to the foundation, then you have an option for an advanced interior design course. That one will not be offered until 2021 because you have to have the foundations class to take that second course. And so That's why that's that 2021. The next one is advanced fashion and design construction. That's the second piece to that. So you go from that foundations class to one of those two classes. Again, 2021 is the school year that that would be offered, and that's available to 10th through 12th grade students. And then the last is a capstone course. So you have that foundations course with both students or both groups of students. Then you go to either one of the two advanced classes, and then there's a capstone course for both of those courses. That's available to 11th and 12th grade students. This would be open for advanced fashion or advanced interior design pathways. They would go into that. And that one wouldn't be offered until 21-22, because at that time, then we would have students that would be ready to go into those courses. And so that is the family and consumer science recommendations. The next is a group of science recommendations. And so we are asking for AP Physics 1 to replace Physics 1. So we're adding a couple of AP courses in this group. Obviously, those would be weighted 1.0 with the AP Physics test. Without it, you'd get that 0.66. Prerequisite is a completion of Algebra 1 or concurrent enrollment in that, available to 11th and 12th grade students. And this would add AP Distinction to our Physics 1 class, and with an emphasis on test preparation. So the next course for science is an AP Physics 2. Same similar rationale between this and the AP Physics 1. You're adding that distinction for AP and an emphasis on test preparation. Available to 11th and 12th grade students. And the next recommendation is to add a physics course, which is not an AP course, replacing our AP Physics C course. And this allows for an influx or a greater number of students to take physics. So we're excited about this. This is our introductory physics course or general physics course. We don't call it general physics because the NCAA clearinghouse doesn't like words like general when you're adding those courses, so we're just calling it physics. So we're hoping that this will entice students to take a physics course, which is recommended. Next course is a mathematics course, and this is a special education course. This goes along with a name change for another course. We're changing Pre-Algebra A, which is an adaptive course, to Algebra Geometry 1A. And then we're adding an Algebra Geometry 2A to allow students in those special education courses to have a better pathway and a track that's similar to our Reg Ed courses and provide them with some additional rigor in those courses. So that's mathematics, special education. And then the last course that we're recommending is a middle school course. It's Technology, Innovation, and Entrepreneurship. This is a course that replaces digital tools and apps. And if you recall, in the recent future or recent past, you approved the data governance provisions where we were looking at student data and alignment to FERPA and looking at privacy rights. So one of the outcomes of that decision is that a lot of the applications that were used in our digital tool and apps class, we can no longer use in the district. And part of that process brought teachers to say, hey, let's change that class. Let's make it technology, innovation, and entrepreneurship, and allowed them to add that entrepreneurship component to it, as well as looking at some of the applications that can be used. So that's an outcome for that. That's a semester-long course available to eighth grade students, and the business marketing and information technology teachers feel that that will better prepare students for a track in college and career success. So those are the recommendations that we have, and I will leave it to you all to ask any questions.
Okay, it looks like that we might have a question or comment from Board Member Doan.
So do we have any way of knowing how many kids would take these classes? And then if we only had three, we just, what's that number if we...
So that's a good question, and that's part of the reason why we visit with the principals during this process. So, Dr. Sharp, I'll let you weigh in on that.
Because I'm always picking on Dr. Sharp.
Absolutely. Most of these courses that we have are replacement courses that are already in place now, and especially if you start with the science group, with the core courses there, we will have robust enrollment in almost every single course that we have. The Family Consumer Sciences track that we have, and I'd like to thank Kathy here in the front row, We have probably one of the most competitive and creative family consumer sciences tracks that you can have. So those classes are extremely robust there, too. I can speak from personal experience as a building principal. I had three teachers for 2,100 students that taught five preps across all those classes. So every single one of them was full. So each one of them, the special education course will help align. So that will help because we already have a algebra geometry 2B, which is a class within a class. And so 2A will help solidify that. So believe me, our building principals have helped vet this process. Because like Eric showed you, it's a six-fold collaboration ending with you this evening to be able to make sure that we can feasibly make this work. So that's my short answer there, Julie.
Thank you.
All right, very good. Do we have any other comments? Okay, Ms. Ritchie?
Yeah, I just wanted to say thanks for taking us through the course approval gauntlet, because that's really, the poor teachers are the ones that have to go through there. I've been through that before, and it's not easy. It is a long process. I'm glad you explained it, because they spend a lot of time going through that process. And I just wanted to thank each of the teachers and the departments that spent all the time upgrading and looking at the needs of your students and doing that, because I think it's going to pay great dividends for our kids in the process of it. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm, very nice. Mm-hmm. Vice President Clark?
Well, I'm going to sound like I have a different perspective, Dr. Flack, but showing what you accomplished in less than 30 days to get this to us, congratulations. I mean, that is amazing. And particularly, and with no disrespect to the other courses, but particularly with these science courses, with the emphasis on career readiness and STEM, those physics offerings are really, really important.
Yeah.
Congrats.
Thank you. And I will add that they're working on this throughout the year as well, so they're constantly working with their staff to process through this.
All right. Very nice. We have a motion, and we do not have a motion yet. Okay, so I'm going to need somebody to make a motion. This would be...
I move that the board approve the addition of the attached courses as presented for the 2019-2020 school year and beyond.
All righty, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? All right, we'll go ahead and take a vote. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And those opposed, same sign. All right, very good. Great work, Dr. Flack. Thank you, and the entire team that worked on that. Thank you so much. Okay, we're going to go into item 10.02. Who would like to talk about this, Dr. Carpenter?
We're excited about item 10.02. It's a small expenditure, but the Finance Committee made a great point. Let's pull this out because it's so in keeping with some of the work we're trying to do for young folks. So at this time, I'll call on Dr. Mathis, representing Team Student Services.
Good evening. I was asked to talk just a little bit about the Y-Tri curriculum that is before you for decision tonight. We've submitted that as a core curriculum for our social-emotional behavior programs in the special education department. This would include Miller Park teachers, as well as our social-emotional behavioral teachers within the programs within a traditional school environment. This would be for K-12 students. Y-Tri was selected with buy-in from each of these teachers. Some of our teachers have already been utilizing some of the materials and resources just because they were already aware of it. And then we did send out a survey, so all of the teachers were committed to buying into this particular program. At this point, they are creatively using a variety of resources to meet the needs of their students. And what Y-Tri will do is provide some consistency and some common language. It also is very much focused on resilience for students. And within our social-emotional behavioral programs, we want to equip our students with the skills to be successful and really face adversity with solid confidence. With opportunities and the freedom to make some choices that are good for them in their life. It is a web-based program, and it stays current and relevant online. It interests students because it does access all of the different modalities. There's musical opportunities, there's videos, there's writing opportunities. Our educational therapist which you have supported, and we very much appreciate that, that we've been able to increase that a little bit to address well-being in the district. We have 12 educational therapists that also help and support meeting IEP goals for our students in social-emotional behavior programs. They will have access to this because the license allows for up to 50 teacher licenses, so they'll be able to support the students' IEP goal needs with that same common language and support in alignment with what the teachers are doing. In addition, our educational therapists are available for all students at the Tier 1 level when we talk about the multi-tiered system of support. Our ed therapists are available for all students, and so when students are requiring more intensive skills-based instruction in how we can address different social-emotional behavioral issues in their lives, they'll have the opportunity to access this resource to work with all students as well. It may be Tier 2 and Tier 3 interventions. That site-based license will be utilized and monitored through administration as well. So we'll have opportunities to have an on-site two-day training with YTRI, and then we'll be able to do some soft implementation of the curriculum during second semester and look for full implementation with Fidelity next fall. And we'll be able to continue to monitor that and meet the needs with ongoing support and training for staff.
Okay, very, very, very good. All right, so for item 10.02, I'm going to need a motion.
I move that the board approve the YTRI program.
I move that the board approve the YTRI program in the amount of $6,000.
Second.
All righty, we have a motion and a second. Are we now are open for discussion? Anybody wish to comment? I've got several here. I'm going to go with Board Member Doan.
So it says up to 50, and that's teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And how many do we, are we going to have exactly 50 or?
We will have 50 included with this purchase. And so what we'll be able to do is train, there's about 20 staff that require the training within our social emotional behavior programs, including Miller Park. And then we'll also be able to offer that training to the 12 educational therapists. And we may also offer that to a few other select teachers and some administrators that will have access to be able to provide interventions for kids.
Because you know me, I want to use up that 50.
Absolutely. We'll get there.
And then tell me about the all-site license curriculum subscriptions may be renewed for $1,500 annually. That'll obviously every year. But for all 50? I don't get that.
Because we're doing the site-based and not individual licenses, it was actually cheaper to do the site-based license option than to buy 20 individual teacher licenses. This gives us that automatic opportunity to renew on an annual basis where we won't have to buy for $6,000 every single year the site license.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Board Member Smith.
Yes, I was yesterday in the Finance Committee meeting, and I was the culprit who ask that this be put over onto into items for decision. I think it's a wonderful program. Uh-huh. Did a great job. We heard this yesterday. And to me, sometimes that things need to maybe come off the consent agenda to be able to see, again, when we're trying to prepare each student for success in life, that all kinds of there are programs out there that's touching bases. The thing I really struck me yesterday was when, and tonight when she said this, was that it's already, some teachers are already aware of this. They have, they are trying this. They're using this. I just think that that's something once in a while we got to, I don't say toot our horns, but we need to let the public know that those kind of programs are going on out there, and the teachers are the ones that are coming up with those ideas. Mm-hmm.
Well, very good, and there's just more opportunities. And as we continue to, you know, to work this raising all students up, opportunities, equity, this just aligns beautifully with it. So, thank you, very nice, thank you. Okay, I'm going to go to Vice President Clark.
I was really impressed when I was on their website looking at the wide variety of school districts that use the tool and we're able to document specific results. So I think this will be really interesting to watch it develop here in this district. So thank you.
Thank you. I would add that it does have research and evidence base when used as both a class-wide, school-wide curriculum and as Tier 2 and Tier 3 intervention tools.
Great. All right, with no further discussion, we're going to go ahead and take a vote here. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And all those opposed, same sign. Excellent. Congratulations. Great job. Great work. Okay, we're going to move right into item 10.03 now. That's our personnel report. And Dr. Carpenter?
Yes, ma'am. We'll turn it over to Dr. Del Sim.
Good evening, Madam President. I'm going to borrow what Dr. Carpenter said, that Team HR has prepared the personnel report this evening for the board's approval.
I move to approve the personnel transactions as presented and contracts issued.
Thank you, Jackie. All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All right, with no discussion tonight, we will go ahead and take a vote. For all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. All right, congratulations. Great work, Dr.
Thank
Del
Sim.
Thank
you very much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're going to move right in to item number 11. This is items of information, a presentation, and this is item 11.01. Dr. Carpenter, would you like to say anything here?
Absolutely. We're going to call on Dr. Daniel along with his team. He has a very, very informative professional development program report, and he also told me that it's very, very brief. Dr. Daniel, get us started.
Yes, sir, absolutely. It's my privilege to be here tonight to present with my colleagues here. The professional development program review evaluation. We have some great leaders with us here tonight. The co-chairs of the professional development committee, Kristen Shackelford and Barb Green, representing the PDC. They are our PDC professional development committee co-chairs, so we're glad they're here tonight. They will do the best work and the heavy lifting here, I'm sure of that. We are data-driven, and we do try to be responsive to needs as it pertains to developing our professional learning. You heard some great commentary tonight earlier from the Parkway School District visit about some things coming down the pike in terms of professional learning. We're really excited about that. We're really excited to partner as a team to meet the needs of our students. Some other things that inform our efforts with professional learning are some of the things listed on your screen, and I committed to being brief tonight, and I've also committed not to read to you things that you can read yourselves. I do want to hit a couple of highlights. The academic systems review that was conducted a couple years ago now, maybe two falls ago, maybe even three now that I think back, that's a huge driver, and one of the themes in there again was equity. We are committed to equity practices. We are committed to professional learning about that. That's very important to us. And we're really committed to providing each student and also each staff member what they need and when they need it to deliver the needs to help our students be successful. That's very important. And another key component of professional learning is making sure that we hear from our staff. Our staff, the boots on the ground, the people working in the trenches every day, they feed us great information about what kind of learning is going to help them be successful. Obviously, the great work that Dr. Collier has led with us as a team with our plan for performance, that is another huge driver. You've heard about those three priorities tonight. I won't talk about those any further. The other thing, and this is a visual for you, you've seen this a few times now, it's really good work. We're really proud of the work, again, that Dr. Collier and the instructional operations team and the instructional team has developed. But it really is just our guiding force. And it is about preparing each student for success in life, the mission that is written up behind you there. So we're pretty excited about that as we move forward. So at this time, I'm going to pass it over to my colleague, Mrs. Kristen Shackelford.
Thank you, Dr. Daniel. Good evening. I'd like to start by highlighting the quote on your screen. You cannot have students as continuous learners and effective collaborators without teachers having the same characteristics. In recent years, the Professional Development Office has experienced a paradigm shift from professional development as an idea of something done to you to professional learning that is rooted in staff ownership. I'd like for you to take a second and look back at our compass. When I think about the path we travel with our students, guided by this instructional compass, we emphasize characteristics such as collaboration, communication, critical thinking. We want our students to have experiences that are authentic and relevant. And I encourage you to think about that same vision for our staff members. We want to hold those experiences and make sure that our staff members also have experiences that are relevant, authentic, collaborative, and with high levels of communication. Centered on these principles, professional learning in the district takes many forms. Lee Summit classrooms are currently buzzing with ongoing cohorts and workshop cadres where teachers come together for a targeted learning experience led by accomplished teacher leaders. On Late Start Wednesdays, teachers are digging into student data in order to drive instructional decisions focused on their students' needs. This year, collaboration expanded to include 4 cross-building collaboration sessions. Another example of relevant differentiated professional learning is the EdCamp hosted for elementary teachers on the November 6th Professional Development Day. EdCamps are organic professional learning experiences created by teachers and for teachers. They're built around the basic collaborative structure of teachers teaching each other what they know. On November 6th, we brought teachers at each grade level together in one location to have conversations about what matters most to them, their interests, their passions, and their questions. Our vision and mission is carried out by the members of the District Professional Development Committee. This committee is comprised of teachers and administrators that represent each building throughout our district. We are tasked with managing the financial disbursement of professional learning money. This 1% refers to money allocated through the state, Missouri House Bill 1543, which requires school districts to dedicate 1% of their formula funding to professional development. I'm going to let Barb talk more about how we allocate those funds.
Good evening. I've known some of you for so long. This is fun. This is the graph. This shows you, our 1% allocation. So I'll point out the blue, the 40%, the committee, 100% approved this budget for this school year. We go by percentages. That is going to the buildings. It's divvied out by number of certified staff per building, so it's fair. That will support the building professional development plans. Teachers are in charge of that money and approve that money. 40% went to CSIP for the build, that's the district wide. Then the yellow after the red, that's the PDC committee. We have to train our committee members to allocate for that blue part to follow state guidelines. We have to make sure that this money is spent correctly and we follow the guidelines. So we do need to train them so we have PDC meetings. BTAP is Beginning Teacher Assistance Program in the green that we do support teachers for the first 3 years while they're in the district. And then new this year is the purple, and that's for principal professional development because they are our educational leaders, and our PDC committee talked about it, discussed it. This was brought to them and to their attention that we need to push our principals to go ahead and not just let their teachers grow, but they need to grow also. So they're going to be on a 3-year rotation to allow them to get some professional development opportunities as an educational leader in their building. So these are some of the programs that have been funded that we're watching for. Some of them are high school specific, so that would be the AVID program. We have specific for elementary, started with the math professional, the third from the bottom, and now it's moved into the middle school where I'm involved in that one. Trauma-informed care would be another one that's district-wide. So some are specific for a grade level, some are specific for a secondary versus elementary, that we are covered in both of those, the blue and the red section with the 80%. I'd like to talk to you about the Beginning Teacher Assistance Program. first year that Kristen is one of the facilitators for. We really work on supporting survival. That first year is so scary, and they meet a little more often, but it's to give them the, oh, we can do this, and give them the background knowledge of how to handle parent conferences, things like that. Years two and three, I help facilitate with some other people from other buildings that have gone through the leadership training. And we all have brought in, on the left of your screen, Marcia Tate, Dr. Marcia Tate. We did a book study with her. We want to thank you for approving the contract of bringing in these two people. They were fabulous energizers. As long as I have taught, I still loved listening to them. It gave me, even as just introducing them and helping them, it was good for my soul to listen to these people. To do Worksheets Don't Grow Dendrites was last year. This year, with BTAP 2 and 3, second and third year teachers, we brought in Dave Burgess with Teach Like a Pirate. We're doing a book study with him as well. But do we thank you so much for approving the contract for them to bring them in. They are full of energy and great for our teachers and veterans. Again, these were some of the programs that we have used the money for that is going to help just not only in the buildings, but district-wide. And with that, I will turn it back over.
You can see how blessed I am to work with such great colleagues. Not only are they great teachers, they are fantastic leaders, and I lean on them heavily to lead as well. One of the things that we're really excited about, we piloted a spring new teacher orientation, and one of the pieces of feedback that we've received over the years is August is so stressful for teachers new to the district. And we thought, well, why don't we just start in the spring and alleviate some of that stress in August? So we created an optional spring orientation, and much to my and our pleasant surprise, 91% of our new teacher hires entered into that learning in an optional situation. That's the kind of talent, that's the kind of dedication that we hire at R7. I was so proud and so pleased to be a part of it. And really, it just supports well-being for staff. Staff are so overwhelmed in August, this just lowers their stress load a great deal. It's a two-day effort. We plan to continue it again. We're really jazzed and excited about that. Another thing that we're pretty excited about, we formed a classified, non-certified professional learning team last year. And that's not at all to say that we haven't had non-certified staff development over the years. It's been really good. But because of this Board of Education's vision and the vision of leadership, if you recall, the Office of Curriculum and Professional Development was split into two different offices. And because of that kind of support, we're now able to do things like spring new teacher orientation. We are now able to develop a classified professional development learning team. So your support, your vision, your energy into this is very much appreciated. Okay, a couple of other things here, and then we'll close. We are really excited about this. Barb and Kristen will be helping lead this, but we plan to submit an application to DESE for the Commissioner's Award for Excellence in Professional Learning next fall. We believe the good work that was started many years ago with Dr. Flack in professional development, and that is hopefully continuing with my leadership. We believe with a high level of confidence that if we apply for this, we will get it. Okay, the challenges and considerations moving forward. You heard it earlier tonight. We need to develop a multi-year plan to meet the professional learning of our staff. And it needs to be differentiated, and it needs to be timely, and it needs to be relevant. Bullet point two, we need to do less, and we need to go deeper, not wider. This will be one of our biggest challenges. I'm just telling you right now, with the calendar that you approved tonight, we have limited time with a great deal of needs coming down the pike, and that will be a significant challenge. The other two things, and then we'll close, how do you measure the impact of professional learning on student achievement? And then how do you correlate professional learning to student achievement? Those are two elusive targets for me personally over the years. How do you measure that the staff development that these great professionals are getting is the causal thing of great student achievement results? That's a hard thing to measure, but we know that we need to do that. Okay, these are just some of the fine professionals that we get to work with and collaborate every day. If you ever want to tweet something out with regard to professional learning, hashtag R7PD. At this point, we'll take it up for questions or comments or suggestions or concerns. We really appreciate your time.
Okay. You always so humbly present, Dr. Daniel, yet we know that you're an impetus behind a lot much of what's going on, so thank you to you and your staff as well. You've got great people you work with here. So, Board Member Doan, I believe you'd like to comment.
Talking tonight, aren't I? I was with a teacher that I've known since high school, and I was with her all last week, so it was 4 days after your professional development day, and she said that, and she's an elementary school teacher, wow, why aren't we just pinpoint her? She told me 2 or 3 times throughout the weekend how great that was, and that it was her grade level, and so she really, so anyway, that's awesome.
Very good. All right. Vice President Clark.
This was a great update, and you guys are clearly dedicated and inspired to be leaders in the district, and we appreciate that leadership. And I think you all were here at the beginning of the evening when we were talking about the district leadership visit to Parkway, and when they were talking about academics and addressing equity and creating our plan, they definitely talked there about a professional learning plan. Have you all been engaging in those conversations, and are you ready to engage with Dr. Smith, or excuse me, Ms. Smith, on building out that part of the plan that they're going to be bringing to us? It sounds like February. I don't want to press anybody on the month.
Great question. These two fine professionals have not been involved directly yet. I would suggest that at this point we're just getting into the conversation. Now that the visit has happened, I'm pretty sure that the rapid pace of the conversations will pick up. I know these ladies, these professionals are up for the task, and we're ready to do it whenever the time is right. Does that help? Okay, great question.
All right. Does anyone else have any comments? Okay. I believe we are ready to take a vote. Nope. Oh, you're right. Oh, gosh. We don't need to vote on this.
Yeah. Please don't vote on this.
Okay. Oh, no. It's a thumbs up, too. So, okay. All right. Very good.
Thank you
so much. Let's give them a round of applause. It was very nice. All right, we're winding down this Thursday evening. Going to start with our roundtable discussions. Oh, I do want to note that there was an item, my apologies, item number 12. We did have one written report. It was 12.01 facilities and maintenance project update. Lots of great things always going on. Are there any comments anybody would like to share about that one? Nope, other than just great work. Yeah, okay. Yeah, thank you for that info. All right, now we'll move into 13, which is our roundtable discussions. And I'm going to start down. I'm going to go to my right. So, Board Member Doan, anything you want to share?
Well, everyone have a nice Thanksgiving. And I don't watch Saturday Night Live, mostly because I'm probably not up. But I heard that there was a comment made from a military guy was on there. I really don't know anything, but I heard this about 2 or 3 times on the news and just wanted to, I don't know, I want everyone to just really listen to this. And I'm since Monday, I've been trying to do this, but I will try hard not to offend, but I will try harder not to be offended. And I just, it just hit me and I wanted to share that, and I'll probably tweet it and put it on Facebook and if I ever get on there. Anyway, have a good Thanksgiving. Thank you.
Okay, Board Member Smith.
Also, like Julie, just like to wish everybody in this district, in this community, a happy Thanksgiving. And we do have a lot of challenges, but we also have a lot to be thankful for. We just need to remember that at times. Mm-hmm. Real quick, I keep picking on Kyle out there. Last month, we talked about some possibilities of some conversation with classified and certified staff, and that was the time maybe some internships down the road, or just in the talking, but to be able to some ladies and gentlemen go out and work on some HVAC or carpentry or whatever it may be. Kyle, I may be wrong in this, and so you correct me. Yesterday in the finance meeting, he was just talking about a school bus that is in the process of being painted, because you can't have a yellow school bus out there by law without, if you're going to do something else with it besides transport kids. But my understanding is some of the ladies and gentlemen at facilities are putting this bus together so that this summer it can be a traveling library for kids to check out books. And I as I sat there, I thought, what a family we have here in in this school district. Oh, okay. But you're painting the bus or whatever, right?
Rudy's painting the bus.
Yeah, Rudy's painting the bus. Anyway, thank you for that.
Awesome. Thank you very much. I'll go down here to my left. Board Member Murdoch.
Yeah, just a couple of quick things. Good job to all of the elementary schools, especially who did Trunk or Treat this year, all across the district. It went really well, and I think that that's a testament to all of our elementary schools staff and especially the PTAs that put those on. That was really awesome. Ours especially, obviously, I'm partial Longview Farm where my boys go. We had a sumo wrestler in my family and a minion that attended those. So that was great. Congratulations to the Lee Summit High School boys soccer team, who is in the state Final Four this year. I believe they play tomorrow in Fenton. And my hope is that they'll play Rockhurst in the final. And my hope is, obviously, that they beat Rockhurst in the final. There's a little bit of history with me and Rockhurst and soccer and stuff when I was in high school. So good luck to the Lee Summit High School boys soccer team. Encourage everyone in the community, obviously, to attend the CFMP engagement series that's going to be going on the week after Thanksgiving on that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday at MIC. And then lastly, just on a personal note, my son Eli finished his first ever competitive soccer season with Sporting Lee Summit and did fantastic. Their team did very, very well. But I wanted to just call your attention to, they have a team name. Their coach is Jennifer Borgstad, and she's fantastic. And their team name is the Ubuntu Strikers. And it made me think about what even Julie was saying down there, because that word just means I am because we are. And she's instilled that kind of mantra with those boys, you know, that they only are a great team because of each other, working around each other. And I just think that kind of applies to everything that's getting ready to come down with all of us here in the community. So I hope that we can kind of take that to heart. Thanks. Have a great holiday.
All right, Board Member Fritchie.
I just like to show that little great gratefulness around Thanksgiving time, but I'd like to say a great big thank you to all of our three Lee Summit high schools. They collected more than 8,700 pounds of canned food, boxed goods, and other supplies for Lee Summit Social Services. You may have had some of them at your doors for Halloween, trick-or-treating, and asking for donations for that. Can you believe that they had that kind of response? 8,700 items. Those items helped fulfill a critical need at Lee Summit Social Services for this time of year. It's really important going into the holidays for that. So that's just one more indicator of how great of our students are in our school district. I also just wanted to give a little shout out real quick to Summit Lakes Middle School. I saw their production of Annie. Totally fun production. Those kids are awesome, and Lee Summit West has some real talent coming their way. I've just got to say that. Also, on November 1st, I just wanted to thank Dr. John Falkenberry at Lee Summit High School, because I was able to do a school visit, my last school visit. I did all the other ones last year. This is my final one, but I enjoyed my visit to Lee Summit High School and found out more information about them, and it was great to have a great conversation with him. Also, kudos to Lee Summit West High School for their speech and debate tournament, their debate and forensics. That was really fun. I haven't judged for a while, and I was able to judge duet acting and Lincoln Douglas debate, so that was fantastic experience working with the kids at Lee Summit West High School. And then finally, just wanted to mention that I did attend the November 8th Equity and Education discussion at the Lee Summit Christian Church, and our own Bob White was the speaker for that, and Dr. Katie Collier. So they did a great job. One of their speakers didn't show up, but these two really carried it, and they did a great job. So thanks very much.
All right, Board Member White.
Again, just happy Thanksgiving to everyone. And if you're planning on attending the December 15th concert for the Lee Summit Symphony, I would really seriously suggest that you go get your tickets now. We have about 800 tickets already out. So it's going to be crowded, and we probably will sell out. So get them early. Thank you.
Okay, very good. Vice President Clark?
I will move quickly. I know others have mentioned some of these things, but I did want to mention that the first trick-or-treaters at Casa Clark were the Lee Summit High School Robotics Team. I was alerted through our Facebook page there in our neighborhood, and they had a nice haul, and I was so pleased to hear that all three high schools collected the 4 tons. That's amazing. I was able to participate in the Holly Festival by, of course, shamelessly promoting the Missouri Tiger tailgating experience, and I'm eager to hear how that went. And then the same weekend, for those who haven't seen it yet, our good friend and alumnus, Mr. Drew Locke, turned 22 and became bowl eligible a week ago last Saturday. I always have to give the Drew Locke report, folks. And Senior Day is coming up. You know what, they should. And Senior Day will be a tearful day, I'm sure, for the Locks, as well as many of us fans and some of us here in this room. I think someone mentioned that Dennis and I participate in the International Baccalaureate Review for Lee Summit High School's program, and hopefully that came out well for us. A little pressure was on. And I also was able to judge poetry at Lee Summit West. This is not one of the events I participated in at Lee Summit High School's debate program, but I enjoyed it, and it was very, very interesting to hear the kids and their presentations and their selections. It was really quite moving, and it really also speaks to us understanding what some of the kids are going through in their lives, and I know those selections meant something to them at their cores. So that was interesting. I don't mean to make light of it all, but it wasn't my event when I was growing up. And finally, because we've been talking about professional development, you know, the board does some professional development, and we are continuous learners too. And I have to give a shout out to the MidCon and Public Library, that Colburn Road branch. On the 14th, the 7th and the 14th, they hosted a two-part seminar on unconscious bias, and I was there. And I know, Ryan, you were there on the 7th, Bob was there on the 14th, Miss Linda was there, and it was a great session. It was led by Loretta Summers, who owns the Summers Advisory Group, and I guess I'm kind of partial to her because she has a corporate background. She was at Sprint, and she really did a fine job, and it was a really great on-ramp for having a good understanding of what we need to know as citizens here of this community about unconscious bias. So I was really glad that I was able to spend time both of those nights and participating and learning. I do have the handout, and I didn't write on it. I wrote notes on something else, so if anybody wants a copy of that, we can share that with you. But again, Seth over at the library and his leadership made that happen. Finally, regarding Thanksgiving, I think we all tend to think about how great things are and we've collected cans. But if you're in crisis and you don't have a place to be on Thanksgiving, our community's taking care of you. Our VFW 5789 downtown, 329 Southeast Douglas from noon to 4, you can have a free Thanksgiving dinner. So if you know of anybody in crisis or need, tell them about that.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Dr. Carpenter?
Yes, ma'am. I'll be brief. In keeping with this theme that I'm hearing relative to Thanksgiving, I started jotting down a few things that I've been thankful for during the first semester of the school year. And these are in no particular order. But first off, an awesome fall sports season. I mean, I think it doesn't take much following on Twitter or braving some cold elements to find out that teams across the district have done a phenomenal job. We've already mentioned soccer,
our football teams. North had the best season in their history, and we really should have won that game the other night. Mr. Shaw, we were right there knocking on the door, and I was running up and down the sideline because I thought we were there, and we lost it there at the last minute, and Rockhurst put three of our teams out. So not only do you have some issue with Rockhurst, but I'm developing it too, Mr. Murdoch. A great week in theater. I didn't get a chance to see a performance, but I've heard so much about the performances at all of our schools. I did get a chance, and I'm thankful for our joint ROTC ball. Got a chance to spend last Saturday evening with that crew, and what an event. I mean, those young folks, they put it all together. It was one night that the teachers cannot say they worked hard because they got to sit back and enjoy the meal, and the kids really, really handled the night, and I got a chance to be their keynote. That was super cool. And I'm also thinking about these staff members during the Thanksgiving time that give so much of themselves. The League of Visionary Educators, they're coming over and they're giving of themselves in the evening. And not only are they giving of themselves once a month and working with this superintendent trying to push the district forward, but you'll pop up at community events and they're there as well, continuing that learning for themselves, and that's super, super important. Also, our students who will remove themselves from the regular school environment, about 40 of them, to spend some time once per month with the superintendent. We had our first engagement last month. What an event. I mean, we brought in a professional graphic designer, and they're going to be coming to you in December, I believe, if we can get this accomplished. And they're trying to develop their branding, who they are, what they want this to be about. And this professional graphic artist spent time telling them the branding has to endure. It has to be something that wraps people in. And they were just all into it. So the other night at the ROTC ball, one kid pulls out his phone. He said, "Dr. Carpenter, I'm on your team. And look, I'm working on the brand." And he's on his phone showing me what his team is working on. It's just super, super excited. The leadership team willing to do a little more, dig a little deeper, and realize that we are going to go into some area that we might not have been in before. When I think about Dr. Whaley and the virtual learning piece that we're trying to keep enhancing, when I think about Don Smith and the leadership around equity and the team that just keeps giving a little bit more, I super, super appreciate you, and I'm sure the same can be said with our building teams. And then this commitment. I went over to the Mid-Continent Library last night myself just to sit, no worries, just to sit in the back and hear what that was all about. And to hear some community members just leaning into a conversation that they might not have had before, it does my heart proud in terms of access and opportunity and how we might just put our practices under a microscope. Mm-hmm. And that's okay from time to time, to put our practices under a microscope to see where we have been very, very good, where we may have fallen a little bit short, and how do we get better. And finally, a loving wife that'll hold a family together when I'm spending these long nights out. She does it without any pause, any hesitation. And even tonight, as little Layla celebrates her sixth birthday, and that's going down as we speak, so I appreciate them. They make me a whole lot better. Thank you all a bunch. Have a great, great Thanksgiving.
Very good. And I will just quickly wrap it up with a couple things. You did mention theater. That's kind of my thing. I'm going to say that I have seen Lee Summit West's production of Mamma Mia, and it was incredible. One of our teachers of the year, Brad Rackers, continues to do great things with those students. I myself am really thrilled that choreography is finished for my show, Footloose, at Lee Summit High School. I spent some time over there working on that show, volunteering to work with those kids, and they have a wonderful show. So if you get a chance, their show plays tomorrow night, Saturday, and Sunday. And then also, Adam's Family is playing over at Lee Summit North High School, and Shane Daniel also does a great job there. I also did go watch our football teams play. I enjoyed watching all of them, and it was great. I saw North play, and I did see Lee Summit West play. Let's see here. I think there's my daughter's studio, Kansas City Dance Company, will be performing at the symphony. I'm helping with that, and so looking forward. I'm glad they're doing one show this year, so it'll be one massive show as opposed to two almost massive shows, I guess. So anyway, so it's going to be great with the symphony. And finally, I just have so much to be grateful for. Every day I count my blessings. I'm grateful for living in a community that embraces all people all the time. It just excites me to have started as a baby here and be sitting up here with all these great folks. So I wish everyone a very happy Thanksgiving. Enjoy, and we'll see you back soon. And this meeting is now adjourned.